And I'm slamming all the doors you've opened. Hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me. I am sure I have reached the end.
friends and family. My name is Nate Koistra. I'm one of the pastors here at Reeman Christian Reformed Church, and on behalf of the Bushen family, I just want to say thanks. I know how much it means to all of them to have you here today, surrounding them with love and with your presence. I also know how much it's meant during the last few days, and also the last several months as they journeyed through a very challenging and difficult time with our sister in Christ, Kathy. And yet you sent text messages, you sent cards, maybe you surprised them with a meal, maybe you just thought about them or lifted up a prayer. Whether you told them you were praying for them or not, they know you were, and they felt those prayers, and they're deeply thankful for each and every one of you. Today we also want to remember the presence of a couple of people who aren't here with us physically, but are very much with us. Kathy's grandson, Eli, wasn't able to be here today. He lives quite a ways away, and yet he was so dearly loved by Kathy and by Ed that we wanted to acknowledge that special relationship that they had. And also, we remember her son, Matthew, who passed away several years ago, and remember the gift that he was and how special he was to Kathy as we celebrate, too, that they have been reunited in Christ at their heavenly home. Kathy played a lot of roles in her life. We'll talk about some of those throughout our service today. But one many of us knew was her role as a nurse, a caregiver, someone who lit up the halls of a hospital, a place that can be very difficult to light up. And so to honor that service that she gave to our community and to so many people, there's a nurse's honor guard here today to just pay some time to reflect on that role Kathy had and to honor her service as a nurse.
Good afternoon. As Pastor Nate stated, we are from the Muskegon Area Nurse Honor Guard, and we just wish to thank you. We appreciate being invited here for this tribute to Kathy. At this time, we will take a moment to light the Nightingale Nursing Lamp in honor of Kathleen K. Bushen. If there are any nurses here today, you're welcome to stand up as we offer our tribute. The lamp is a symbol of everything for which Florence Nightingale stood: comfort, kindness, gentleness, courage, and unwavering devotion to duty. May Kathy's light shine endlessly, just as the light of the lamp has in the past, does in the present, and will continue to do into the future through all those who have known and loved her. Nursing requires giving oneself to enhance the lives of others. As we join together today, it is apparent that Kathy's lifetime of commitment, of caring, has touched countless lives. Nursing is a calling, a lifestyle, a way of living. Nurses here today honor Kathleen K. Bushen and her life as a nurse. Kathy is not remembered by her years as a nurse, but by the difference she made during those years by stepping into people's lives, by special moments. When a calming, quiet presence was all that was needed, Kathy was there. In the excitement and miracle of a birth, or in the mystery and loss of life, Kathy was there. When a silent glance could uplift a patient, family member, or friend, Kathy was there. At those times when the unexplainable needed to be explained, Kathy was there. When the situation demanded a swift foot and a sharp mind, when a gentle touch, a firm push, or an encouraging word was needed, Kathy was there. In choosing the best one from a family's thank you box of chocolates. Kathy was there to witness humanity, its beauty, in good times and bad, without judgment. Kathy was there to embrace the woes of the world willingly and offer hope. Kathy was there. And now that it's time to be at the Heavenly Father's side, Kathy is there. Kathy, we honor you this day and give you a white rose to symbolize our honor and appreciation for being our colleague. Kathleen K. Bushen. Kathleen K. Bushen. Kathleen K. Bushen. We officially release you of your nursing duties. We present this lamp to the family of Kathy. This lamp is a symbol of everything for which Florence Nightingale stood: comfort and kindness, gentleness and courage, and an unwavering devotion to duty.
Thank you for that beautiful tribute to a wonderful nurse and a wonderful servant. Today we come with all sorts of emotions. No doubt we've had plenty of those throughout the week, but they hit ever more so today. And sometimes we don't know what to do with our emotions. Sometimes we bottle them up. Sometimes they come out in ways we wish they wouldn't, but we experience them and we find ways to express them. And the most helpful source is through Scripture. The Bible addresses every emotion that any human being has ever experienced. And so today we turn towards Scripture. And the psalmist gives us space to grieve, to feel the emotion of grief that many of us, all of us, carry today. He says, "The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He saves those who are crushed in spirit." In a lot of ways, we are brokenhearted today to have lost Kathy. In a real way, our spirits do feel crushed. I look back through my text messages this week that I've exchanged with Kathy Bushen over the years, and I saw that on December 1 in the year 2021, I had sent her a text message asking, "Kathy, would you be willing to sing at our Christmas Eve candlelight service?" She quickly replied, "I would love to." Just a couple days later, I saw a text from her daughter Bethany, who was using her mom's phone, letting me know that her mom wouldn't be able to do that because she was sick. And so we grieve the fact that we never heard that song or all the other songs that Kathy had to offer this world. We grieve the fact that we can't call her on the phone, that we can't pop in for a visit, that we can't run into her in the halls at the hospital. We grieve the loss of a sister, of a mother, of a friend, and of a child of God. And God says when we're brokenhearted, he's close to us. He's close to those who are crushed in spirit. But Scripture doesn't leave us in that place. We're not people who grieve without hope. We grieve in a different way because we have something that changes the way grief affects our lives. We also come today and turn to Scripture to find comfort in the midst of our grief. We need a place to take it, someone to carry it for us. And Jesus, while he walked the face of the earth, he looked out at a broken world. He looked out at disciples who had all sorts of pain and struggles and hurts in their lives. And he said to them face to face, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." So we come to find We also come to do something that is extraordinarily important. We come to claim the certainty of eternal life. It's the very same thing that we claimed together several years ago at the funeral for Kathy's beloved son, Matthew, when we read these words from the book of Romans. For I am convinced, we were then and we still are today, that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. Would you join me as we come to him in prayer? Lord, we feel brokenhearted in so many ways. For the last year plus, we had prayed and prayed and hoped and hoped. We had longed for a different result. And yet, even in our grief, you come to us with words of comfort, and you invite us to claim the certainty that even though Kathy's earthly life has come to a close far more quickly than we would have hoped, her eternal life has just begun. And so as we gather here today, may we feel your presence, knowing that nothing can separate us from your love. May we feel that, and may we know it deeply. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. One of the more important things I think we do at a funeral is to just take a moment and reflect on a life that was lived to the glory of God, a life that was a gift to us, and a life that really God used to tell us a bit about his story and how he's at work in this world. And we do that through sharing of memories. So I have quite a lot of memories to share today. Four family members have written some beautiful words, and so I want to read those for them. But I also want to invite you to continue to share memories with the family in the weeks and months ahead as they continue to reflect on the gift that Kathy was to all of us. First, this is Kate Bush, Kathy's niece. Kate writes, I had the absolute pleasure of being Aunt Kathy's niece. But even though I was just that, her niece, she always treated me like a daughter. Our family's close, closer than a lot of families I know. All of us cousins grew up together, and my aunts are like my second mothers. We're really lucky. We got three moms for the price of one. I always looked forward to my family gatherings, whether that was for the Joling Christmas party or spending the summer up at the cottage, and Aunt Kathy was a big reason for that. She brought the joy, the energy. Kathy brought the fun. I can't help think of Kathy, who I affectionately called Peach Lips, without smiling. Because when you were with her, you were smiling. And even if it was your toughest day, she'd wrap you up in a bear hug. She was the person you wanted to be near. You gravitated toward her. She was magnetic, filled with life. One of my favorite memories of her is when our entire Joling side of the family got together in Tennessee. And every morning, the kids would wake up to this thunderous laughter from the Joling sisters downstairs. It was always punctuated by Kathy's almost scream/laugh. It made sleeping in nearly impossible. I loved that about the sisters. This chorus of laughter that follows whenever they're together. I cherish summertime chats with Aunt Kathy on the boat, swim platform, and waving to her as Uncle Ed sped by us on White Lake with Aunt Kathy in the bow, wind in her hair. I think God called her back home so he could fill heaven with more laughter. She's finally able to give Matt a big bear hug again. It's hard to put into words who Kathy was and what she meant to me. She made life more fun. She was one of my favorite people in this world. I'll love and miss you forever, Peach Lips. From Kate. some memories shared by Sandy Pohl, Kathy's youngest sister. Kathy has always been a very important person in my life. Growing up together, she was my dearest friend. We played paper dolls and Barbie dolls for hours. We loved playing Monopoly under the Christmas tree with just the Christmas tree lights on. I still have that memory whenever I smell a Christmas tree. Kathy was always the creative one. We would swing on our swing set, and we would sing songs. We even made up several of them. We always sang, "You Are My Sunshine." And Kathy surely was mine. We loved to sing. We started singing in church at a young age. We loved singing together and sang in churches, weddings, at weddings, baptisms, and funerals our entire life. My favorite song was "Come, Let Us Worship the King," because Kathy always sang with such enthusiasm and joy, and boy, could she hit those high notes. Kathy always had a boyfriend, but when she met Ed, she knew he was the one. She loved you dearly, Ed. I always looked up to Kathy. She had a great influence on my life decisions. I went to Calvin College like Kathy, Blodgett School of Nursing, and became an RN like Kathy. I worked in surgery like Kathy. I married a boy from Fremont like Kathy. She and Ed set us up on a blind date. I'm so thankful for them. My sisters and I remain best friends. We vacationed together in Colorado, Tennessee, the Smoky Mountains, and of course the cottage, raising our kids together, spending hours in the boat laughing at the kids' antics on tubes and skis around the campfire. Aunt Kathy was always the fun aunt who came up with crazy games to play. Christmas parties were always fun. Kathy always had great gift ideas like theme baskets and the awkward family photo book. We made an anniversary book together for Mom and Dad's big anniversary with fun memories on each page. She was the game planner for almost every wedding and baby shower that we hosted. She was the life of the party. Kathy and I went on a medical mission trip to Honduras. We were asked to sing there. We sang, "Go Light Your World." Kathy did exactly that every day of her life. Kathy had a strong and bold faith. Even when faced with extreme grief and the loss of Matt, her faith remained. This past year has been filled with devastating news, but even cancer couldn't rob Kathy of her smile, her joy, and her wonderful sense of humor. My son-in-law made an interesting comment this week. He said Kathy had a way of making everyone in the room feel welcome and special. I'm sure we could all agree. Oh, how we'll miss her. But I know full well that we'll be spending eternity together someday with our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Because like Kathy always sang, "He's alive and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide." From Sandy, thank you. And some words from Kathy's daughter, Bethany. She writes as if it's a letter to her mom. She writes, "Mom, words could never adequately express how much I love you and admire you. I'm beyond blessed to have been able to call you Mom. You're a shining light in a world full of darkness. Your smile, your laughter, and sense of humor are some of my favorite things about you. You never took yourself too seriously. And I loved your ridiculously silly side. We have some great blackmail-worthy pictures that are definite t-shirt material. While at a family reunion in Tennessee, Mom made the silliest face, and it was zoomed in on and enlarged and then placed on a t-shirt. Not sure who ended up with that one. Somebody's got it. But aside from those silly faces you frequently made, you are the most beautiful woman I've ever met, inside and out. Your beautiful soul radiated through you. You are the matriarch of our family. and the glue that held us all together. Your smile lit up every room you entered, and your laugh could be heard miles away. You had such a loving, accepting, fun-loving, and caring spirit. You were completely selfless and had such passion for caring for and helping others. You loved volunteering, and we got to experience helping the less fortunate together with our Reeman Church family in Guatemala, memories I'll cherish forever. One of my highlights from that trip is watching you play with some of the school-aged children. There was a group of young girls who were drawn to you, and I'll never forget how much you made them laugh and the smiles I saw from them and on your face as well. Even though you spoke different languages and couldn't communicate with words, you demonstrated to them love, acceptance, and compassion. I remember even though you weren't supposed to, you gave them almost every piece of jewelry on your body, with only the exception of your wedding ring. Their faces lit up like they just won the lottery. You were truly a living example of how to treat and care for others. God's light shined through you in everything you did. You taught me how to love God and nurtured my faith in every way possible, including sending me to a Christian school to provide me with a Christian foundation for the rest of my life. You taught me how to love deeply and fiercely to those deserving of it, and even those who aren't, which has been both a blessing and a curse. You raised me to be fiercely independent, strong and resilient, which has helped me throughout my life. You inspired me to become a nurse. We shared a love for traveling, music, boating, shopping, and helping people. You always encouraged me to pursue my dreams, even when that included selling my house in Michigan and moving across the country to pursue travel nursing in San Francisco and traveling all over the world. You were the best example of how to be a Christian, a wife, mother, sister, grandmother, friend, and nurse. Some of the best compliments I've ever received is that people say they can see your spirit, your love, and your joy in me, and that we share the same smile. I've seen the same thing. I've convinced that God takes his most faithful, loyal, precious, and gifted children first. So it's no surprise that he called you home so soon. Plus, your son Matthew has been waiting long enough to be reunited with you. Moments before you passed, you opened your eyes and gave Dad and I the biggest smile. It was such a blessing. I'm convinced that was the moment you gained your wings and were welcomed into heaven by your Lord and Savior, and that Matt was there to welcome you home as well. My heart breaks to lose my mother and best friend on this earth, but I know in my heart and trust that you will forever be by my side or looking down on me, guiding and protecting me from above. I will always carry you in my heart and spirit, and I will meet you in heaven someday. Give Matt a huge bear hug for me, and give Teddy Bear and Moxie a squeeze for me too. I love you forever. Love your grateful and blessed daughter, Bethany. Thank you, Bethany. And then one last one from Eric, who is a nephew of Kathy, and he also writes, "Dear Aunt Kathy," says, "The cliche goes, there are no words. And some cliches are around because they're true. In the coming days, weeks, and months, many of us will try to find a way to describe your impact on our lives. And I, for one, know that I'll come up short. So please forgive me, because this is my attempt. Growing up in the Christian Reformed Church, we used little jingles to help us memorize Bible passages. As I was thinking about what to write, one of those little jingles kept repeating in my head. It was a passage from Galatians that I'm certain you know well, describing the 9 fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those traits, they were alive in you. You live them every day with everyone we encountered. Take love, for example. There was no one who loved more fiercely than you, Kathy. You loved with a passion, and it was enveloping. It was the way you'd just calmly take someone's hand to comfort them. The way you'd look people right in the eye when they spoke to you. The fact that you always ended your phone calls by saying, "I love you." And your love for Ed, Matt, Bethany, Adam, and Jason was inspiring. I remember looking at your marriage to Ed and thinking, that's what I want when I grow up. Thank you for always doting on us, because in case we didn't say it enough, we loved you right back. You radiated joy, and I'm sure most of us can hear your laughter even in your absence. There's no one sitting here in church today who pictures you with anything but a smile. You had peace in the face of unimaginable tribulation. When you found out you were diagnosed with cancer, you were committed to fight, but you were not afraid. You were at peace with the possibility of what lay ahead and confident in where you would go. You had patience in spades. Who could forget the vacation where my siblings and I spent all week debating whether to adopt a Bernese mountain dog? I think I just saw Uncle Ed cringe, he says. You probably don't want to hear those words again. Three boys, one girl, a score of cousins, a neighborhood of kids, and then, of course, Ed Bushen. That might be all we need to say. There was a lot of mischief in our house. Yet it was more likely to hear you laugh than to hear you raise your voice. You were kindness personified. When people were in the darkest moments, you always brought the light. For as long as I live, I will not forget how you called me the night Maureen had her first ectopic pregnancy. Aside from being a calming presence, you told me that while everyone would be worried about Maureen, you wanted me to know that you hadn't forgotten about me. That was the most comforting thing anyone said to me. And of course, it came from you. You and your sisters all display a goodness that has inspired the generations that have followed. All four of you have been guided by a strong set of values and convictions, and they've kept you all so close for your entire lives. I know my mom will only be able to cope without you because she's full of the same goodness. Your faithfulness never wavered. In your darkest moment, as your sister Sandy sang Amazing Grace at Matt's funeral, you raised your arms in praise. That was undoubtedly the saddest time of your life, and yet you turned to God in thanks. You were so gentle, tender, and thoughtful. You were the first person to send a card, to know when someone needed a pick-me-up. Your personality was so easygoing that everyone gravitated to you. You lived lightly, and maybe that's why our hearts are so heavy. To be honest, self-control might be the only fruit you struggled with. I sometimes wonder if you ate anything other than M&Ms and Diet Coke. In seriousness, though, there were plenty of moments when I'm sure you wanted to holler at Matt and me, just take us by the ear and give us a piece of your mind. But you didn't do it. You let us learn. You let us grow. You let us be reckless boys. And I really appreciate that. Please note that we'll cry today. But those tears will be brief. Your presence in our lives means that our memories will not be marked by our mourning. We'll spend the remaining years celebrating you. You've gone to join the Spirit who bestowed on all of us his fruits. And in doing so, showed all of us how he intended those fruits to grow in us. And right now, it just doesn't seem fair that he's taken you when we all needed you for so much longer. But I know that's selfish, because you're in a much, much better place. There's another Bible passage from John in which Jesus promises that in his Father's house there are many rooms. I sincerely hope he gave you a whole house, and that it looks just like the big blue one on White Lake you always admired. And so as you enter your eternal home, please give Grandma and Grandpa my love when you hold Matt again, please tell him that I miss him. And I've tried to live every day with half the spirit Matt had. And please, when you see Chad, tell him I've done the best I can to play the role of the big brother. But he left me too big of shoes to fill. I love you, Aunt Kathy. We all do, and we always will. Thank you for all you were, and you leave behind, all you leave behind for us to carry on. Love, Eric. Pastor Les Van Dyke also expresses his sympathies to the family. He wasn't able to be here today, but he has such fond memories of Ed and Kathy. He's walked with your family through some very difficult and also some very joyful times. And he just wanted to let you know that he too has so many memories to share and celebrate, and I'm certain he'll share those with you down the road. I too have great memories of Kathy. I'll share a couple of those in my message, but I thought of her as I think of a lot of people that might be sitting here today. I've been a part of Reeman Church a long, long time, so I feel like it truly is a family extension of, and I think Kathy was like an aunt to me. She was a Reeman Church aunt. When I was thinking about the funeral today, and I was wrestling with whether or not I should maybe shave my beard and trim my hair because it's getting a little out of control, I thought, Aunt Kathy wouldn't care at all. And I love that about her, because I think she loved us as we were. We have a PowerPoint that's going to make you cry more. Well, it's beautiful. I know the family spent some time digging through pictures, and nothing can really tell the story as much as a picture. So at this time, we'll put down the screen, and I'll invite you for it's about a 10-minute video or so to just kind of reflect on Kathy's life as you kind of take a look at some of these photos.
I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Money. this forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine
Bethany, you even look exactly like your mom when Dad scares you behind the boat on the tube. That's remarkable. What a beautiful tribute and some great memories to share. Would you join me in a prayer just thanking God for the gift of Kathy's life? Lord, as we just reflect on Kathy Bushen, her life, the person that you made her, you created her in her mother's womb many years ago. You made her special. You made her unique. You made her in your image. You also saw every day of her life before it happened, and you wrote a beautiful story. We wish it was longer. And yet you, in your wisdom, knew when the time was right. And we know that you continue to write her story through her family. So we just thank you for every day that we got to share with her. It was a gift, a true joy, a true honor. We receive that gift from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we just kind of reflect on Kathy's life, I was thinking about what scripture passage maybe resonates with me when I think of Kathy. And there was one that kept coming out over and over, and it requires a little bit of background in the Bible. I'll give you that as we go through the message. So if you're at first a little lost, I promise we'll get you there. But this passage from the book of 2 Corinthians really caught my eye and made me think of Kathy, and so I just want to share these words with you today. The Apostle Paul writes, "We're not like Moses," another character from the Old Testament. I'll say more about him and his story in a moment. "We're not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to prevent the Israelites from seeing the end of what was passing away. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. The Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." The look on someone's face can tell a story no number of words could ever tell. For the last few years, I've been the middle school boys' coach of the basketball team at Fremont Christian School. And every game before we start, I can look in the eyes of those young boys and I can tell you exactly how they're going to play. If their eyes are glassy and distant, I know it's going to be a tough go. If you walk into your home and your loved one has some really great news to share with you, even before they say a word, you can see it on their face. A couple of weeks ago, when I ran into Ed at Walmart, before I even had to ask how he was, I already had the answer by the look on his face. The look on someone's face, it can tell a story that no number of words could ever tell. The book of Exodus tells a story about a man named Moses who went up to the top of Mount Sinai, and he had a conversation with God. And Moses' first question when he stepped into the presence of God was this. He said, "God, show me your glory." That's what he wanted to see when he stepped into God's presence. And then he spent 40 days having a conversation with God. And then after that, basking in the presence of the glory of the Lord, Moses, he walked down from Mount Sinai, and the look on his face was almost too much for the Israelites to handle. He had been so close to God for so long that God's love and God's glory and God's beauty and God's grace was literally radiating out from Moses' face for the entire community to see. The look on someone's face, it can tell a story that no number of words could ever tell. But as Moses continued to speak to the Israelites, the glory shining from his face began to fade. And so Moses would then cover his face with a veil so that the people of God wouldn't see God's glory fading away. In 2 Corinthians, the text I just read, the Apostle Paul picked up on this story from the Old Testament, and then he applied that story to the lives of everyone who turns to the Lord, everyone who becomes a Christian, everyone who gives their life to following Jesus. Paul says when that happens, that veil is taken away so that all of us with unveiled faces, we now reflect the glory of the Lord. Like a full moon that has no light of its own and yet the sun shines so brightly on it that through the moon light bursts in to the darkness. When the glory of God shines upon his people, it radiates through them for the world to see. We live with unveiled faces. When I think of Kathy Bushen, I think of the look on her face. It told a story no number of words could ever tell. When I came back to Reeman Christian Reformed Church as a young pastor who was in many ways scared to death of standing up in front of people and giving a sermon, I remember I learned quickly to lean on the look on Kathy Bushen's face. She sat right over there next to Ed most of the time. I vividly remember one Sunday when I had included a joke into my sermon that I thought was really, really funny, but for the most part it felt completely flat. And then I looked over at Kathy, and she had a huge smile on her face, and then the sound of her laughter broke the silence. The glory of the Lord was shining on a young preacher through the face of Kathy Bushen when I needed it the most. Of course, if you've ever had the opportunity to be at our church, Reeman Christian Reformed Church, on Easter Sunday, you know exactly what I'm talking about. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. And it wasn't just the words that helped catch us up in the resurrection story. It was the look on Kathy Bushen's face that helped us all believe. We could see resurrection life beaming from her face. It was filling our hearts with hope and with peace and with joy and with love that comes from knowing the love of Jesus Christ. Look at someone's face. It can tell a story that no number of words could ever tell. Kathy knew something that I'm sure she'd want all of us to know. It's the same thing the Apostle Paul knew when he said, we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and then present us in his presence. Kathy knew the grave not the end of the story. She knew death doesn't have the last word. She knew that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because even death itself can't keep us from entering into the presence of God and basking in his glory. When Kathy mourned the loss of her beloved son Matthew, we might have wondered if the glory shining in her face would begin to fade, at least a little bit. When she journeyed, of course, through the agony of cancer and all that goes with it, who could have blamed her if she no longer felt the energy to radiate God's love? Although she certainly had days when it must have been harder for her to sing, we all still saw the love of Jesus shining through her face. She reminded us that we have a God whose glory and love shines upon us in both joy and in sorrow, in happiness and in suffering, in life and in death. God doesn't cover up his face when our lives grow dark and painful. Instead, he invites us to approach him with unveiled faces, even if we have tears streaming down our face. To come to him just as we are, into his presence, so that we can see him face to face, so that we can catch a glimpse of the God who loves us more than we could ever imagine. So as we mourn the loss of Kathy today, we lean on the words of the Apostle Paul, who said, "Therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day." And so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen, it's temporary. But what's unseen is eternal. This week, Ed told me that Kathy had a picture in her mind of what heaven would be like. And Kathy fixed her eyes on that vision. She imagined that as she walked into the open spaciousness of heaven, she would look over and she would see her son, Matt, running at her as fast as he could, with his larger-than-life smile on his face and nothing to hold him back. He would wrap his arms around his mother, pick her up off of her feet, twirl her around in a circle, and tell her how much he loved her. Kathy fixed her eyes not on what's seen, but what is unseen. She knew that what's seen is temporary, what's unseen is eternal. She knew that the love of her son would never fade away, and that the glory of the Lord would last forever. And when we know that, we can live with unveiled faces. We can let the glory of God radiate through us like light shining in the darkness, like resurrection life bursting out of an empty tomb. So today we do not lose heart, because today we fix our eyes on Jesus, knowing that one day he'll call us all home to be in his presence forever. Amen. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, we want to see your glory. We want to see your love and your beauty on display in this world. And when we do see a glimpse of it, it moves us in ways we could have never imagined. We're thankful that through Kathy Bushen, you showed the world your love and your peace, your compassion, your grace. We pray that as we continue to mourn her passing, Lord, that you would help us to see your glory even in the dark days. You would help us to see your presence even when it hurts. And that you would shine through us, just like you did through Kathy, for the world to see your presence and your love. We thank you for Kathy Bushen, a child of God and a dear sister in Christ. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. As we end our time together, sometimes families will go to the graveside and have a ceremony there. Other times we'll do a committal here, and today we'll do a committal in the sanctuary. And this is that kind of last moment where we say goodbye. We say goodbye to a dearly loved sister, someone whose face lit up a room. And saying goodbye is a very difficult thing for us to do. But we come as people who say goodbye in a different way, knowing that one day we will be reunited together again in Christ, in the new creation when God makes all things new. And every week, almost, at Reeman Christian Reformed Church, many of the weeks when Kathy was here, we would end with a blessing. And I think it's a fitting blessing to also end at the end of a service for a funeral. It's a blessing about the face of God. It means a lot every week when we say it. Perhaps it means even more so as we reflect on the fact that God's glory shines through our faces. And the blessing is simple. It's the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. The look on someone's face truly can tell a story no number of words could ever tell. And so as we say goodbye to Kathy today, we look into the face of our Heavenly Father. And we're thankful that she is in the care of the one who created her and knew her best. And so we offer her soul into his caring and loving hands. We also commit the family into the care of the Christian community. Encourage all of you to continue to remember Ed and everyone in your prayers, to send cards, to send texts, to stop by for a visit. The months ahead are a difficult road, and your support means a great deal. Today we've lost someone we love deeply, but we know that our Heavenly Father has taken her home. And so we have peace in that. This concludes our service for this morning. After our service today, you're invited to stick around and have lunch with the family, share some memories, just touch base with them. You'll just kind of head out these back doors. The food's right there. Just go ahead and grab a plate and be seated and spend some time with the family. I'm sure they'll very much appreciate that. The funeral home at this time will dismiss you by rows after they dismiss the family. So please stay seated until the funeral home does that.
Gathered round your grave to grieve, wish I could see.
caught her on the road from a lonely cold hotel room just to hear her say, I love you one more time. And when he heard the sound of the kids laughing in the background, he had to wipe away a tear from his eye. Little voice came on the phone and said, Daddy, when you come home. He said the first thing that came to his mind, I'm already there.